We all know it. Walked it every day. But none of them were like these. The world's most dangerous ways to school. Freezing. Climbing for hours. Bailing non-stop, all for the chance of a better life. Spectacular and sometimes simply beautiful. The world's most dangerous ways to school. The Sierra Madre Occidental in northwestern Mexico. Here, scattered in the mountains and far away from civilization, live the Rarámuri. The way to school for the children of the Sierras is a dizzying hour-long march. Their goal? The boarding school in Huizuchi. It is one of the most dangerous and longest routes to school in the world. For their dream, the children overcome a more than 1,000 meter change in altitude and often trek until they are on the verge of exhaustion. But their hunger for education is stronger than the fear of tumbling down the narrow, steep slopes. The children know that school gives hope and is their gateway to a better life. Monday, 5:30 in the morning, in the village of Ripuchinari. A plateau in the midst of the vast Sierras. It's freezing cold here, 2,300 meters above sea level, where at night it often falls well below 5 degrees Celsius. Like every day, the 6-year-old Teresa first makes a fire. This is the only way for her 8-year-old sister, Angela, her mother, and the 9-year-old Philomena to warm up. Like most Rarámuri, the family lives from its corn crops and their livestock. The parents' cows and goats spend the winter in the warm valley below. Only the chickens are kept on top of the plateau year-round.
I feed the 10 chickens every day. And then I'm happy to go to school.
The class starts at 9 o'clock in Huizuchi. The girls are always especially well-dressed for school, in their traditional outfits of self-made flowing skirts and brightly colored blouses. On their feet, they wear thin sandals called huaraches, their only protection against the cold ground in winter.
Barefoot, it's really cold. With the huaraches, it's better.
A quick comb through their hair and out. School begins in 3 hours.
Take good care of yourselves. Bye-bye.
The Rarámuri speak their own language with the same name, Rarámuri. This makes it impossible for them to find work in the city. The 25-year-old Aniceta sends her daughters to school so that they can learn Spanish, even if getting there is very dangerous.
My thoughts are often with my children when they are on that difficult path. They could get hurt, and I imagine them sitting somewhere crying. I miss my children during the week. I could really use her help with the housework.
That is why not all the Rarámuri children go to school. Without their help, many families in the Sierras simply could not survive. Like most children from this area, Teresa, Philomena, and Angela stay in the boarding school during the week. The route through the Sierras is too strenuous and dangerous to do every day. While the girls have long been on their way, 1,000 meters below in the valley, the day now slowly begins. Hidden in the middle of the Sierras lies Chapatari, a small village with 30 inhabitants. None of the simple huts made from stone and mud have electricity or running water. Shortly after 6 o'clock, Lorenzo wakes up. His mother died giving birth to his little brother. Since then, his uncle and grandmother have taken care of the 6-year-old. Lorenzo is not happy. He doesn't like the way to school. For breakfast, there's fresh spinach and homemade corn tortillas, a rare feast. The family just barely survives on whatever their garden will produce. Crop failure has caused the family to go hungry more and more recently, and there is just no money to buy food.
I like going to school. There's always something to eat.
That's why many parents send their children to boarding school. 3 times a day, the students are fed, and it's free. The Mexican government pays for boarding school. It's 6:30, and Lorenzo now has a 2-hour walk through the Sierras ahead of him. 2 long hours, where the 6-year-old will have to navigate through paths of loose stones, leading over steep slopes. Lorenzo's uncle would prefer to accompany the boy on the dangerous path.
The entire route is difficult. There are many rocky and steep places. Of course I want to go with him, but I have so much work in the fields that I have to stay here.
Lorenzo won't come back until the end of the week. During that time, he sleeps at school. After 30 minutes, Teresa, Philomena, and Angela have reached the edge of the high plateau, the easiest part of the path. In the red bundle, Philomena carries fresh clothes for the week.
We live so far away from the school that we leave our books there. They are much too heavy to carry back and forth. That would be too difficult.
The 3 girls don't have much time to learn at home anyway. They need to help with the housework when they are there. If need be, they even miss several days of school. The girls' destination? The elementary school of Huizuchi, the only one within 6 hours. As the crow flies, there are only 1.5 kilometers separating the girls' home from the school, a seemingly short journey of a few minutes. But only seemingly.
We must walk down the slope here, then through the forest, and up the other side again to the school.
Angela, Philomena, and Teresa must climb all the way up this ledge, a single cliff of 300 meters. But first, they must navigate the way down. Classes will begin in 2.5 hours. It is a trek over the harshest of terrains just to get to school in Huizuchi. It's just before 7 o'clock, and director Genoveva Cruz Cruz is preparing her lessons. She teaches the first and second grades. The 6 and 7-year-old children all sit in the same room. Genoveva lives in the neighboring town. It takes her 6 hours by car to get to Huizuchi, as long as it's not raining or snowing. That's why she sleeps here from Monday to Friday, as do many of her students.
The routes that some children take to get here are very long, and at times, really very dangerous. All sorts of accidents could happen. They could fall, for example, or be attacked by an animal. A lot could happen to them on their way here.
In Mexico, education is compulsory, even in the far reaches of the Sierras. No one really knows just how many children in the mountains work with their parents instead of going to school. An estimated 40% of the indigenous people in Mexico are illiterate. Among the Rarámuri, the rate is even higher. For Mexico's indigenous people, such as Lorenzo, education is free, from primary school all the way to university. But only few children make it to university. They are needed at home to work. Lorenzo has been on the road for just about half an hour. And for the 6-year-old, there is only one direction. Up. To get to school, he has to climb 1,000 meters. Each step is carefully considered. One slip and Lorenzo could sprain or break his ankle. Except for some grazed knees and shins, nothing bad has happened to him yet. The Rarámuri live scattered across the Sierras. Lorenzo only rarely sees people in the area. On average, less than 2 people per square kilometer live here. It is one of the most sparsely populated places in the world. If something were to happen to him here, it would take days for someone to find him in this deserted place. Teresa, Philomena, and Angela have been on the road for a little less than an hour. They have made such good progress, they can even take a short break. The girls have a treat in sight, an Apache pine tree, one of only a few to be found on the steep slope. The three have plans for the seeds. They are perfect for the small snack in between, but getting them is not that easy. Chew and spit. The girls just want the juice from the seeds, one of nature's candies. They taste like pine nuts, only slightly more bitter.
The long trip to school makes us hungry. That's why we eat the seeds. The juice and the seeds taste really good.
The students can use a little refreshment. The first dangerous obstacle of the descent lies ahead.
Hey,
The last part is easygoing for the students. But to get to the valley, the three must first descend an extremely steep slope. It's exactly this spot that their mother begs them to be careful about each time they depart. Lorenzo has been on the road for less than an hour, and the temperature is soaring. The climate in the Sierras is similar to that of the desert. At night, it can easily cool down to freezing, while during the day, the thermometer can rise to 25 degrees Celsius or more. Put the jacket away quickly and keep going. Under no circumstance does Lorenzo want to be late for school. He's happy that he can soon play with his friends.
Down there, the way is easy. I have no problems there. But from here on, it gets steeper. And above, there's a really difficult spot.
The difficult spot is this ridge. Extremely steep, full of boulders, and not more than half a meter wide at the narrowest parts. Step by step, Lorenzo works his way from the valley up to school, constantly checking his footing. No risks taken here. The last few meters, and then Angela, Philomena, and Teresa must face their first challenge, this bluff. They're beginning to feel the strain of the day's early start and the long road. Teresa, the smallest of the three, falls behind. Just over the ledge lies the real difficult part. Their mother once broke her arm here. The morning dew makes the rocks slippery. And it's shady here the entire day.
This is a dangerous place. Or as our mother always says, we need to be especially careful here.
The sisters don't take their mother's warning seriously. Instead of going carefully step by step down, the girls prefer to jump down the stairs. For them, the Sierras is more like a large playground than a dangerous place.
Hold on, boss. Uber.
The hard part is behind us. It gets easier now for a while.
While the girls have fun, Lorenzo has been going uphill for an hour now. His feet and legs are tired, and he still has dangerous passages before him. This is a very draining hike for Lorenzo. But if you know where to look, even in the barren Sierras, you can find something to eat. Lorenzo plucks the leaves of a creosote bush. His people believe that it possesses healing powers.
I eat the leaves because I'm hungry. I pick out the soft leaves. They taste good.
Lorenzo eats as much as he can. The leaves need to give him enough strength for the rest of the way to school. Even if he might be late for school, the six-year-old takes a break. His feet need to rest.
There I have a blister from walking, and it really hurts. My shoe rubs there constantly, and here it also hurts. Here in front by the big toe, because my toes always hit the front of the shoe.
Lorenzo must continue with his sore toe. There is no doctor for miles around in any direction, nor disinfectant or blisters bandage. Philomena, Angela, and Teresa's school begins in an hour and a half. It's not unusual at all that girls go to school. The Rarámuri have always held men and women to be equal. Despite playing around, the sisters are making good time. But Teresa has fallen behind again. Her sandal is broken. The huaraches are simple sandals made from old tire rubber and leather straps. They can be repaired easily.
These are my old shoes. They break often. I need new ones.
New sandals cost 200 pesos, 2 days' wages, approximately 13 US dollars. When the harvest is over, most men have to leave their families and work as day laborers to earn some extra cash. The money they make goes for staple items, such as food like flour and corn. New shoes are usually at the bottom of the list. Around 100,000 Rarámuri inhabit the Sierras. They are the largest and poorest indigenous group in Mexico. The majority live below the poverty line of $1.25 a day. As is the case with Teresa, Angela, and Filomena's parents, their livestock and crops are not enough to survive. Other family members, like the grandfather of the three girls, must also be fed. To make money, the mother weaves baskets. The 25-year-old sells them in the neighboring villages or exchanges them for food. It's not unusual that such a young woman already has three children. According to Rarámuri tradition, you reach adulthood at 15 and may then drink alcohol and get married. Accompanied by her father, Aniceta looks for new materials for the baskets. This can take hours. Although he is a man of advanced years, he has no problem keeping up. All Rarámuri are good runners.
As a child, I walked barefoot, without the huaraches. Then we began making them from cow leather, and now from old car tires. I used to do running races here in the Sierras, and one twice. I still travel a lot these days when I do the shopping, down into the valley and back up the mountain.
Rarámuri means those who run well. This indigenous group is famous for their long distance runners. They can run hundreds of miles at a time without a problem. With their villages scattered all over the mountains, the Rarámuri are forced to be constantly on foot. Their settlement of this rough terrain was due to the arrival of the Spanish conquistadors 500 years ago. Only in the seclusion of the Sierras could they live almost undisturbed until today. For the baskets, Aniceta needs the leaves of the sotole. The tree grows almost exclusively on rocky overhangs, which makes cutting the blades extremely dangerous.
This spot is very difficult and dangerous. Take good care of yourself. You better not slip off, or you will go crashing down.
What else can I do? I need to make the money.
In order to make the basket beautiful, she needs the bright green leaves all the way at the top. For each basket, Aniceta makes the equivalent of $3. A bit further, in a small valley, Lorenzo reaches his biggest challenge. The narrow path leads Lorenzo directly along the face of the cliff. Anyone from his village who wants to go to Huizuchi must pass along here. There is no other way. In some places, the rock path is about 2 meters wide, but in others, it is only 50 centimeters. One last deep breath before he takes on the most dangerous challenge of the day. Lorenzo doesn't like this part of the trip at all.
If I fall here, I will fall very far down. I'm quite scared, that's why I go very slowly. I'll be happy when I'm in the boarding school above. Then I won't have to pass here for another few days.
The abyss under Lorenzo is 300 meters deep. Every step, every move, must now be right. The rocks here in the Sierra Madre Occidental are a mixture of limestone and volcanic deposits, an extremely porous and brittle combination. At any time, one of the stones could break away under Lorenzo's feet. Without a safety rope, Lorenzo climbs up the steep, narrow point. Luckily, until now, no child has ever fallen from the wall. Lorenzo has been on his way now for 1.5 hours. His legs are getting heavier and heavier as the road gets steeper and steeper. But the 6-year-old must remain vigilant. Many people have been injured on their way here before. This one last ledge, and then Lorenzo can leave the cliff behind him.
I'm glad now that I made it up here. But further up, there is again another difficult part.
The way over the ledge has taken a lot of strength, but he can't take a break now. Lorenzo still needs another hour to get to school, which lies all the way up just behind this mountain peak. Shortly before 8 o'clock, the girls have managed more than half of the way. Now comes the best part, the break in the river. It's almost dry at the moment.
If it rains a lot, the river gets so high that we cannot cross it. Then we have to go back home.
When the water level is high, the students could fall into the raging river, and none of the girls can swim. Today, the students are lucky. They make it across the river without any rain. The weather can change in the Sierras from one moment to the next. In the dry season, it almost never rains. But when the rain comes, it comes with a vengeance. At times, it can pour the entire day. Lorenzo can't continue when it's raining. The rocks are then too slippery and muddy to get up safely. He must wait in a cave for the weather to get better. Rain is not the only danger in the mountains. Wild animals, such as cougars and coyotes, are also lurking in the Sierras.
Here on the road, I once saw a coyote. I was really afraid it would bite me.
Today, Lorenzo won't be able to make it to school by 9 o'clock anymore. The valley where the girls are has been spared from the rain, but the road is hard enough without a downpour. A 300-meter-high rock wall still separates them from school. Should it rain, it would be all that more difficult for Angela, Philomena, and Teresa to reach that height. The rocks, too steep, too smooth. It will take the girls about half an hour to get up there. They have to watch out what they grab onto. The bushes can hide poisonous snakes. They've made it. It's just after 8:30, and the girls are in Husuchi, with 170 inhabitants, the largest village within a 6-hour walk, and the only village with a school. Despite their pauses, the girls arrive just before classes begin at 9 o'clock. Around 100 children attend the school, all Rarámuris. The students from the village and those with an easy way to school are often there an hour before classes. They use the time to play. The rain has stopped, and Lorenzo begins again to make his way through the mountains. With every step he takes his destination, the school gets closer. He has 700 meters below him, 300 meters still to go. Weather permitting, the 6-year-old will make it to school in half an hour. But first, he has one big final test before him.
I always have to go up this steep incline to get to school. This is a very steep and difficult part of the way. Even if it rains, I have to go up here. There's no other route to the top, so this is the only way for me to get to school.
Lorenzo is not the only student who must travel along this passage. Sometimes he meets other children here, but he prefers to face it alone. The sun has dried up the way quickly. Now Lorenzo will no longer slip as easily. Nevertheless, he has to be careful that he doesn't get his feet caught somewhere, lose his balance, or fall. He's made it. Lorenzo's feet are hurting again, but he takes the pain in stride to meet his dreams.
When I grow up, I want to be a teacher, maybe. Or I could have lots of animals. Cows, donkeys, and chickens. I would like that.
Just one more ledge, and Lorenzo is in Huizuchi, 1,000 meters higher than when he started. Today it took him just short of 4 hours, almost twice as long as usual. But more importantly, Lorenzo has made it unscathed through the Sierras. While Lorenzo walks the last meters alone towards the school, classes begin. Maria Sanchez, the school director, rings the bell to begin classes. On Monday, school always starts at 9 o'clock instead of 8. Many children have a long way to school and often come late. Philomena is in the second grade, which shares a classroom with the first graders as well. First subject of the day is Spanish.
Please take your books out. If there are no questions, we'll begin now to read the novel.
The children need to read a text in Spanish and then answer questions from the board. It's Filomena's turn. Her question, where do we find literary texts? A classmate helps Filomena and spells the solution. The student scribbles the word novela on the board. A novel. There are now only a few meters left for Lorenzo to reach the school, and they are very easy.
I'll be glad when I have the way here behind me. I'm already looking forward to school and my friends there.
The schoolyard. Lorenzo has reached his destination. It's just after 10 o'clock. Lorenzo has only missed the first hour. The classroom door is locked, although it is normally always open. Has the teacher locked the door? Finally, he has cleared the last hurdle. Since it was cold and windy outside, Señora Genoveva had locked the door. She simply ignores Lorenzo's late arrival and continues with a lesson. Social studies is now on the lesson plan. How Huizuchi used to be and how the village has changed today. Lorenzo puts great effort into copying what is written on the board. It seems to come easier to the other children.
Already there are huge differences in their learning levels. The children who are always here make good progress. Among those who are only sometimes here, you notice that there is no one at home pushing them. There the learning stops. The children from in town simply learn much faster than the children who come from far away.
Four teachers work here in the first six grades of the primary school, la primaria. This is followed by 3 years middle school, la secundaria. And those who want to go to college must first finish 3 years of high school, la preparatoria. 12 o'clock, lunchtime. During the week, students get breakfast, lunch, and dinner. The food is free for all children. It's an attempt to combat hunger and malnutrition, which is a major problem here in the mountains. Today, there's a sauce made from canned sardines with potatoes and peas and tortillas. The pita bread is the staple food in the Sierras.
Fish with potatoes tastes good.
The lunch break is 2 hours long. Classes then resume at 2 o'clock. Teresa now has art where the children can paint what they want. Teresa likes drawing bears the most. Lorenzo has something like tutoring in the afternoon. The students do their homework under the supervision of a teacher. 4 o'clock, school's out. The girls have something special to do today. They're going to the corn beer festival in the village. They will be serving goat meat, a feast that the girls get only very rarely. Everyone who comes will get something to eat and drink. Sharing is a Rarámuri tradition. The Corn Beer Festival is a mix of ancient rites and the Catholic faith. The Rarámuri celebrated only on special occasions, such as birthdays or weddings. Today, they pray for rain. The colorful costumes and dance are meant to please the gods, because water is scarce. The average rainfall is only about 400 liters per square meter annually. And indeed, after 10 minutes, it starts to rain and becomes bitterly cold. The hot soup with goat meat is exactly what is needed here. In this cold, wet weather, the girls would normally prefer to return to boarding school. But the prospect of getting a bowl of meat soup, tonari, is just too tempting. The students are among the first that manage to get something to eat at the feast. The children find refuge by a wooden shed. It offers little protection from the cold, rainy weather, but at the moment, that's not important.
The meat is very good, but it's just too cold.
The ceremony is over at sunset, and the girls are not allowed out later anyway. Lights go out at 8 p.m. They must all be back at boarding school by then. Around 40 children sleep at the boarding school.
No one gets to leave anymore. All children inside, everybody in his or her own quarters. Let's go, quick, come on.
Sleeping quarters are a simple welded metal hut. It's a temporary solution until the new dormitory is completed. Until then, the girls sleep on six bunk beds, often three to a bed, just like Teresa, Angela, and Philomena.
Lie down. Soon the lights will go out. Let's go. Lie down now.
At night, it can get down to 0 degrees Celsius without any heating. Then, the thin blankets alone are not enough to keep warm. So all the kids go to bed fully dressed.
Good night.
After the girls, it's bedtime for the boys. Like the girls, several children share a mattress. Even Lorenzo sleeps with two friends in a bed.
Are all the boys here? All here?
Lorenzo is the first to fall asleep. The long and dangerous walk to school through the Sierras and the lessons were just too exhausting today. Now, like all children in the boarding school, he dreams of a future with no worries or poverty.